President Muhammadu Buhari has approved the review of 368 grazing sites across 25 states in the country. This is to determine the level of encroachment. The directive followed the recommendation of a committee chaired by the Chief of Staff to the President, Professor Ibrahim Gambari. The committee is to collate from states and confirm the status of grazing reserves, assess the percentage of available land and those with existing encroachment complications for case-by-case resolution. It will also make recommendations for gazetting of ungazetted grazing reserves and create a database of national cattle herders and ensure grazing reserves are well communicated to all stakeholders. President Buhari wants the assignment undertaken with dispatch to bring more understanding on grazing reserves and implementation. Members of the committee include Kebbi State Governor and Vice Chairman National Food Security Council, Abubakar Baguru, Ebonyi State Governor and Chairman of National Economic Council Subcommittee for National Livestock Transformation Plan, David Umahi, Minister of Water Resources, Suleiman Adamu, Minister of Agriculture and Rural Development, Sambo Nadono, Minister of Environment, Muhammad Abubakar, Deputy Chief of Staff, Adeyikpaye. This development comes amid controversy over grazing reserves as southern governors enact an anti-open grazing legislation. Meanwhile, former Vice President Atiku Abubakar has again insisted on the need for restructuring to unleash the potentials of various constituencies that make up Nigeria. Atiku, who spoke at a book launch in Abuja, says it is obvious that Nigeria is not necessarily a nation and only restructuring will help make it so. Arise correspondent Chinasa Samuel has more.
For the umpteenth time, the former vice president is calling for restructuring of Nigeria, which he believes will lead to national development. He accuses the present administration of unbuilding the nation by taking conscious and deliberate actions that not only make nation building more difficult, but also undo the achievements made in that regard by previous administration.
In my view, we must restructure our country in a manner that allows various segments to develop at their own pace and not be held back by the center or other segments. Development cannot wait for nation building. In fact, neither development nor nation building needs wait for the other. Development can indeed help in nation building. We can walk and talk at the same time. I find it amusing when people declare Nigeria's unity as fixed and non-negotiable while doing everything in their power to destroy that fragile unity. Nothing in the relationships among people is fixed for eternity. You cannot declare your marriage as non-negotiable while doing everything to sow seeds of discomfort in that marriage. Countries can be created by force. You can whip groups of people into forming a country, but you cannot whip them into forming a nation.
The Ekiti State Governor, Kayode Fayemi, who was present at the book launch, however, calls for caution while calling for restructuring. He calls for peaceful approach to achieving a better Nigeria for all.
For me, the idea of remaking the nation should not suggest a strategic demolition for us to erect a totally new structure. The question that we must, however, be willing to answer is where the inhabitants of the country as big as Nigeria will take shelter if we must collapse it, because for many, especially if the idea of remaking Nigeria includes unmaking Nigeria.
Speakers at the event agreed that dialogue remains imperative if Nigeria is to march forward to genuine democracy and nationhood. Chinasa Samuel, Arise News.
All right, Tundu, your views on these two stories.
I mean, initially, or on the face of it, it would seem like a juxtaposition of two entirely different topics, but they're actually related, aren't they? Because,
yes.
I don't know, we do go from the sublime to the ridiculous. Just when I was congratulating President Buhari on, you know, finally signing the PIA, even though it's rife with criticisms, at least he got that out of the way. That was the sublime. Now the utterly ridiculous. We're back talking about Grazing reserves in 25 states. Mm. What 25 states? After 17 southern governors have resolved that they are banning open grazing in the south, mm-hmm. and they're passing legislation to effect that. I believe the deadline was August 14th, mm-hmm. where all the southern states will pass legislation. So if my math serves me well, we have 36 states in Nigeria. If these 25 states are the subject of this committee, that means 11 states are left out. Which ones are the six states among what those southerners have decided that they do not want this grazing reserve? So I don't understand what President Buhari is trying to achieve here, other than stoking discord, distrust, and disaster, which is the link to what former Vice President Atiku was saying about saying the unity of the nation is non-negotiable. I would love that. I'm a believer in one Nigeria, but it's not one Nigeria at any cost. All the constituent parts of Nigeria must feel respected, must feel valued, and that their voice is being heard. I always talk about recently, Gordon Brown was saying about Prime Minister Boris Johnson, as old as the United Kingdom is, that it cannot be assumed that the kingdom will stay united.
Yes.
All the different cultures in all the different parts of the four nations must be respected. All their aspirations must be respected. All these dialogues need to be held. There needs to be mutual respect. I don't understand what this presidential review is meant to achieve. When they determine the grazing reserves, and then what? I'm waiting to see.
But Tundu, don't be surprised. He told you during the interview Arise News Channel had with the president. He said he was going to get the attorney general and they were going to bring out the old dossiers on grazing reserves. He said it.
But those
so
don't
he's
exist,
just
though.
Done what he said he would do.
But they don't exist.
Yeah, but
what
he said it.
What he referred to was in reference to northern Nigeria. There are not 25 states in northern Nigeria.
Oh,
that
yeah?
25 states implies that some of those states are in the south.
Hmm.
Great so, what is this? Here we go
Dr.
again.
What has been established in this matter is that, you know, all this controversy about grazing is incendiary. It's a very sensitive subject. And many commentators on the subject have made it very clear that the federal government of Nigeria must be careful about it. 17 governors of the southern states have come together to say that, look, this cannot work. In the northern part of Nigeria, they have 29 states. The point has also been made all the way to a 1964 case that, look, grazing, there's an existing ruling of the court saying that there's no such thing as open grazing applying to the southern part of Nigeria. And that case has not been put on appeal. The 17 governors of the southern states have also said, you know, they don't want open grazing in their states. Some of the states in the southeast have in fact gone ahead to enact legislation to say this is not possible. So when the federal government now makes it its priority to say, oh, the places that have not been gazetted will be gazetted, and the president is quoted as saying that this should be treated with dispatch. Hmm. I think the president, if indeed he said so, you know, has failed in that regard. He has committed the errors of the politics of proximity. The politics of proximity, it's, you know, it's like ethnicity, it's like tribalism, it's about nepotism. You using your position to defend the interests of those you think are your own people to the exclusion of others. And that's very dangerous in a federal system. So, however, we're told that the decision that has been taken by the federal government now is based on the recommendations of a committee led by Professor Ibrahim Gambari, who is the chief of staff to the president. Now, in 2018, in an article written by Mr. Eric Teniola, who had served in the presidency, who is a journalist, a veteran journalist, and who understands the subject, he writes articles based on research and data. He pointed out that, look, in 2018, Professor Gambari, as Chancellor of the Kwara State University, was one of those persons pushing for grazing reserves in Kwara State. And he went ahead as a chairman of a committee set up by the president, and he has come up with this recommendation that even places that are not gazetted should be gazetted. And that in 25 states, those old grazing rules should be brought back. Now, politically, I think it's a very wrong move. Because it will be misinterpreted. If there are 19 states in the north And then you are saying in 25 states. So what are you trying to do? It means you are not responding to economic realities, to political realities. In 1940, the British, as colonialists, they tried to make a distinction between what they call grazing lands and farming lands. And that was a colonial thing. And that was what became, eventually, in 1964, 1965, the Northern Grazing Law. Mm-hmm. That Northern Grazing Law applies to the North. It does not apply to the South. So what are we dealing with here? Is it a case of the Gambari Committee trying to impose his will on Nigerians? Or is it a case of the president saying that there will be grazing routes, whether Nigerians like it or not? Now, one of the major issues that came out of the conversation from one part of the country is that many of these grazing routes, they've been occupied either by farmlands or by structures, mm-hmm. right? Even if they existed as part of the divide and rule politics of the British in 1940, right? But there's no central law in Nigeria that says there will be open grazing. So is the Buhari administration trying to introduce a central law to legitimize open grazing? I think that this should not be a priority for the Buhari administration. President Buhari should be more interested in leaving a legacy with regard to education, yeah. with regard to security, yeah. you know, in the country, rather than worrying about a matter that is so heavily ethnically determined. That is my view on this subject.
First it was Ruga, then it was the water bill, now it's this gazetting of grazing reserves. All right. Yeah. Well, what next? Really? What next?
We'll soon find out,
we'll
I'm
soon
sure.
Find out, right? That's all to do.
On the news headlines, we'll take a short break now. When we return, we'll have Rotus Adiri, Michael Wilson, Adesua Amorua, and Aaron Akirijola to give us updates on Africa and global business, COVID-19, and sporting activities across the globe. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Morning Show here on Arise News. Our dependable Rotus Adiri is here to give us an African business update. Good morning, Rotus.
Morning, Tundu. Good morning, Doctor. Good morning, Rufai. Good morning to all our viewers. We begin with oil and gas. The NNPC, State Oil Company for Nigeria, has inaugurated a board, the Greenfield Refinery Limited. Mele Kyari inaugurated the board in Abuja just yesterday. And what this is now a subsidiary of the NNPC. It is set up in order to oversee the operations of the NNPC's assets, that is specifically refineries. They're also going to be looking at taking equity stakes in new credible refineries, focusing on modular refineries. They're going to be looking at trying to solve the downstream issues, downstream petroleum product issues that Nigeria has been facing. Mele Kyari, by the way, is chair of this board. He also charged them to make sure that, look, they've got to make sure that their operations are profitable going forward, in line with what we've seen with the Petroleum Industry Act. So it's, again, it's the Greenfield Refinery Limited. And again, they're going to be charged with, as far as refineries are concerned, operations and also making sure that their investments positively impact the Federation accounts. That's the bottom line here, as well as also working things out with the downstream petroleum products. We move to aviation. NUATE, which is the Nigerian Union of Air Transport Employees, their Secretary General, Mr. Ochembe Aba, has said that Nigeria's concession plans, which we talked about earlier in the week, Doctor had a question about the existing legal issues with one of the concessions, existing concessions with MM2 in Lagos. They said it's going to fail. It's not going to work because, and he used a really, I hope it doesn't sound corny, he used a pretty good pun. He said that Nigeria's concession plans have too much baggage, which I thought was clever. So they're carrying to existing baggage, which includes, according to him, about 50 legal cases on various aspects of existing concessions that are already in place. He also talked about the actuary valuation of in the thousands, the Federal Airport Authorities of Nigeria, the FAN, their existing employees, that they have to be valued in terms of what happens to them going forward with concessions if private entities are going to take care of them. So he says there's too much going on right now, and they will actually document all these things and put them out for the public to know on Tuesday next week, which is the 24th. So we'll find out more. So, you know, this is, to use local parlance, you know, pouring sand in the gallery of the government's plans, because whatever private entities are hearing this now, they're like, oh, there are existing issues with concessions in the country. They're going to find out on Tuesday. So, you know, there's a lot of baggage as far as the concessions is concerned. More aviation news. IATA, you're looking at Will Walsh. He's the new head of the International Air Transport Association. And he says that about $143 million is locked in foreign exchange, cannot be repatriated out of Nigeria. And he said it's a big issue. It's not just Nigeria. About $983 million is locked in across a number of countries. There's a chart that we'll put up there, an IATA, or rather an FX chart for you. You'll see, says that these countries, these four countries, Zimbabwe, Nigeria, Bangladesh, and Lebanon, account for about 60% of repatriated funds, FX, belonging to airlines that cannot be taken out due to a number of issues. So Zimbabwe is at $142 million that's locked in there. Nigeria, locked $143 million locked in. Bangladesh, $146 million. Lebanon is, unfortunate to use the term, a basket case, and good luck to them getting any money out of Lebanon right now. Lebanon has a full-blown FX crisis. So those countries account for the most amount of funds. We move to Kenya. Uhuru Kenyatta, well, the National Treasury of Kenya, just released financials up to the full year ending in June 2021. What they are owing contractors has risen by 8% year on year to $3.3 billion. That's about 389 or 390 billion shillings. It's affecting or impacting construction work in Kenya. Uhuru Kenyatta a year ago gave a directive saying that they should pay it off. And it goes to show you that these directives don't really go anywhere unless there's money to pay these people. So you can issue all the directives you want. If the money's not there, the money's not there. So Kenya, of course, has been impacted by COVID-19. They've tried to, you know, their budget deficit, they're trying to narrow it down to about 7.5% of GDP or so. But, you know, so the money's going up. It's increasing what they owe contractors in Kenya. Finally, we move to South Africa. ShopRite is testing a cashier-less store in Cape Town. The gentleman that you see gesticulating there is ShopRite's Group Chief of Strategy, Neil Schroeder, explaining how this works. Essentially, there's no cashiers. There isn't even any checkout points. It just uses artificial intelligence, machine learning, cameras. You pick up an item and you just walk out of the store and you are billed automatically. Amazon Go is doing this over in the West. There are some stores that are testing it out in the United States and in Europe. So, of course, South Africa being the most industrialized and most technically advanced nation in Africa would, of course, obviously be the first African nation to test it. Right now, they're testing it only with ShopRite employees. What happens if you pick up an item and you change your mind and you put it back and things like that? So, but it's good stuff, and that's our African business update for
right.
today.
Real quickly, Rotus, when Nuate came out to say that what is it called now with the aviation sector, the concession of the airport will not work, they are really correct when you look at it. There are a lot of landmines. There are court cases. There's the bicotany angle to it. So what are they going to make of bicotany? You know, that did some work as regards that local airport. There have been some court cases. Then the union, how do you unbundle all of that? So I think the federal government should think through these things before they go to put an advertorial like that on Financial Times. Because I saw that advert first on FT, and
why
I'm like,
why did they do that? Why? That's the question.
That's the shocking thing. Why would you even go put it on FT?
Why did they? Why? Why did you do that when you knew you had all these kids?
You have all these problems. Then you went to put the adverts on Financial Times. Then people will come now. They'll say, oh, these guys are not serious. I beg.
As for the cashierless store, I am not keen. All these bots are trying to take over all our jobs. We must resist. We must stop them. I'm all for technological advances. But really, and I do want to say, it's not as easy and as seamless as it sounds. Like you said, all kinds of things could go wrong. Even when the ones that do exist now, when you try and use them, you swipe your barcode. Sometimes that's how you get assistance. There still needs to be somebody sort of hovering around. I don't approve.
Well, quickly, Rotus, if you still have some time.
No, this is advancement. This is technological advancement.
I'm resisting it.
We still have time, very quickly, why are we setting up a new structure? Greenfield Refinery Limited, we're told, to set up refineries, acquire refineries, to do 250,000 barrels per day, at a time when we have a petroleum industry act that is supposed to, you know, do new things in that industry. And also, the government has set up a presidential steering committee, and part of the toxic assets and liabilities that presidential steering committee will have to deal with includes these refineries. So it looks very strange to me. Is there a problem of communication between the NNPC, a company that should be slowing down as we enter a new phase? And as for Kenya, the interesting thing for me about the Kenya story is the involvement of China. China accounts for most of a larger portion of the debt burden that Kenya is facing. Domestic debt, yes, contractors and business people, they may not have been able to address that. But the bigger problem they have is with the Chinese railway and the inability of that country to settle the Chinese. Are we going to have a Zambian situation at some point in Kenya?
Doctor, I asked myself the same questions about the NNPC decision. It looks kind of rushed. But, you know, the NNPC, they own the refineries. They are looking. Mele Kyari said, look, you have to be profitable. He mentioned the fact that with what's going forward, the NNPC and the corporatization of the NNPC, if you're not profitable, he actually said this, you're out. That was the quotes in the in this day article on this particular headline. So I wonder the same thing, but you know, it's overseeing their assets. They're doing the same thing that they did with the Dangote refinery. They're, you know, and that's where we are. I would have thought they would have allowed the midstream downstream regulatory commission to come into fray. It's only 6 months from now, and then you can oversee all this. But that's a regulator. We will just take them at their word and hope everything works out, Doctor.
Well, thank you, Rotus. Moving on now to more business updates. Michael Wilson joins us from London. Good morning, Mr. Wilson.
Yeah, good morning. A cocktail of worries, really, over the end of the week. Good job there's a weekend coming up so that people can go away and think some sensible thoughts about what's going on, because there's been a lot of worries, stuttering jobs numbers from the United States, rising COVID and all the rest of it, and still digesting the Fed's inevitable tightening. But when is the big question? So Chinese stocks have fallen, mainland Chinese stocks down about 1%, Hong Kong down a bit. China tech stocks in particular tumbling, renewed concerns about the severity of Beijing's regulatory clampdown, Tencent and Alibaba, the usual ones that come down. There is a thing called the Nasdaq Golden Dragon Index of US-listed Chinese stocks, and that's down 5%. So that's how the week's ending there. Japanese automakers have fallen as well this week. Toyota, Nissan, Honda. Toyota announcing that it's going to cut production, slash production, I should say, by 40% because of the worldwide shortage of semiconductors. The burglary, the theft of cryptocurrencies goes on. This time it's a top Japanese exchange. This one's called Liquid, where a number of its digital currency wallets have been, as the company put it, it's been compromised. Elliptic, it's a blockchain analytics company, said about $97 million has been stolen. Nothing from the thieves so far. Let us therefore go to the United States, and I'll give you a quick recap on what happened there. US stock futures, choppy, but unchanged, basically. A backdrop of, well, people are on holiday. They call it in the trade thin liquidity, but that's what it actually means. Nobody's around to take any big decisions about anything. Again, the Fed tightening and all the rest of it, you know, plenty of time to think about these kind of things over the weekend. I think that any market action that we see today and indeed next week is also just going to be on thin trade. So it'll be very volatile. Here at Morrison's, the board has accepted a further offer, this time £7 billion from CD&R, Clayton, Dubilier and Rice. What is the future of Morrison's? Will another bid come in? Of course it will, and it'll come in from Fortress. So although the board is recommending this, the shareholders don't have to make a decision, I think, until roughly October. I'm not exactly sure what the absolute date is in October, but there's plenty of time for more offers to come in. UK retail sales have slumped slightly, 2.5 month-on-month fall. It was expected to be a 0.5% month-on-month gain. So it's missed by a fair amount. I think it just shows that people are sort of slowing down after their initial spending after the pandemic. But the good, better news on government borrowing, COVID restrictions have meant that it's 10.4 billion. It was felt to be 10 billion lower than July last year. So something's actually happening there. Just quickly through commodities, both oil prices, WTI and Brent, down on worries about demand, and gold. Well, it's had quite a strong week, actually. We keep gold till last. It is a safe haven commodity. It's had a relatively strong week. The Fed confirmed, as I told you, that we've been talking about this, that some kind of tapering is going to take place, and that will help gold. That is your global view.
Mm. Exciting times there, but I just want to look at those retail prices. You know, month on month, it's slipping down. People are not going out to get things like they used to do before. Why? Because of this Delta variant. What is really happening as regards this? It is shocking. And another thing I'd like to bring to your notice, you know, we talked about this 2 days ago, and now it's happening. Mr. Kwarteng, the business secretary in England, has said he wants to look at that deal again, that deal between Ultra and Cobham's. I mean, is that the right way to go as regards that deal, looking at it critically as regards national security and this Delta variant? What is it going to do to the world economy?
Shopping first then, and of course, yes, people, I mean, we've had another survey out this morning saying that people are less willing to buy big ticket items, and I, you know, fully sympathise with that. It's about caution, really. They're looking towards savings. They've had a bit of a splurge after the pandemic. You'd expect that. They're allowed out. Restrictions are falling in this country. Vaccinations levels are rising and so on. So therefore, people are going to go out, but they're still relatively cautious. They don't know about unemployment. They don't know about where the job's going to be. They don't know what the pattern of working's going to be. There's a whole load of uncertainty about right now, and so the world is a fairly cautious place. As far as looking at strategic assets are concerned, absolutely sensible. Why wouldn't they? Ultra, which Cobham have come in for, deals in submarine sub-hunting software and also weapons aiming software. Now, quite clearly, it would be handy for a hostile government to get their hands on that, and who knows what can happen. So, yes, of course he is. Not before time. Same with Meggitt, though I suspect that Morrison's will be slightly different. I don't think people are too worried about what's happening on their supermarket shelves right now. But again, that's going to be quite interesting, because we've seen 8 times the interest from overseas companies in UK companies since the beginning of the year, 8 times since this time, 2 years ago before the pandemic. So that shows that a lot of people are eyeing up British companies and saying they're worth buying.
Well, Michael, you go ahead.
No, go on. Don't worry.
Thank you. Well, you did say that people are sort of holding back of big ticket items, so it's not the best time to be looking to buy a car, with Toyota also announcing, similar to Tesla, similar to Volkswagen, that they're having to cut production of their cars because of the chipageddon, I think it's been called, chip shortage. Do you see any light at the end of the tunnel this year, next year, when?
I can't answer the question as to when. If I knew when, I wouldn't be sitting here doing this job, would I? I'd be making fortune somewhere, being able to predict things absolutely correctly. I think what we're going to see is, as more countries particularly come in and fill the gap, as they undoubtedly will, the gap is really basically about from companies like Huawei and so on, who pride themselves, and Samsung, priding themselves on the semiconductor market. Now, again, they've all been taken by surprise by the rapid rise in new car production and people's willingness to buy after the pandemic. I think things will eventually level out. When? I don't know. Possibly early next year, maybe. Who knows? Second-hand car market is booming hugely. But I think that a lot of people are actually sitting on their hands right now. They know that technology is changing. They know that fossil fuels are being phased out. They know that EVs are coming in, electric vehicles are coming in. Question is when? I don't know when that's going to be, because the infrastructure at the moment is not there, and they are extremely expensive. And as I was saying to you yesterday, we wondered whether it was going to be called Tesla or Tesla yesterday. I'll go with Tesla. You go with Tesla, I think. It doesn't matter.
Definitely
going with Tesla. Okay. But all right. But that's, you know, what you're seeing there is what Elon Musk was alluding to. It's difficulty of delivery. Well, get your finger out, Mr. Musk.
Well, Michael, I have a set of comments. I hope you can deal with it very quickly. About Toyota, I mean, when I read the Financial Times front page story today. I was concerned that, look, Toyota is being linked to global economic growth and also asset purchase program and, the stimulus program in the United States. And I was wondering, was the Financial Times not stretching it too far? But, you know, I wanted your comments on, one, this Japanese cryptocurrency heist. This is not the first time it will happen in Japan. There was an incident in 2014. And recently, we had the case of Poly Network with regard to a gentleman called Mr. White Hart. He decided to return maybe about half of the $600 million that he stole. And now we have cryptocurrency also being stolen in Japan from Liquid Global. What else do we know? This gentleman in Japan, is he going to return part of the money too? Is he also on an experiment like Mike Hart, who attacked, White Hart, who attacked Poly Network? And then I read a piece about advice consistently given by Warren Buffett, about the best investment. And he's saying, look, when there is high inflation, which is not avoidable, which is to be expected, it's better for you to invest in businesses that are people-oriented, businesses in which you just make a one-off investment and you don't have to make further capital investments. And the story was saying, look, Warren Buffett has been consistent in this regard. And he was also talking about what you call diversified index funds. What are your views in terms of investments in that regard? Is Warren Buffett right? Or we should just take his word, on the face of it?
No, take nobody's word. Go to see your investment advisor, who knows a lot more about this subject than I do. But if you're talking about defensive investments, they're not difficult to do. They won't grow very fast, obviously. But they're things like utilities. They're talking about things that people have to buy. They're talking about healthcare and so on. It's products that people actually have to buy and have no choice in it, and therefore that's what you do defensively. As far as individual companies concerned, if you're worried about them, don't touch them with a barge pole. But don't take my advice about it. Go and see an investment advisor. As far as Toyota's concerned, I think that it's pretty well known that there is this shortage at the moment. When it's going to finish, I do not know, but it's actually causing quite a lot of problems, and it will cause problems not only for car manufacturers, but everything that uses semiconductors, and let's face it, most things do right now. And your first question was, what was your first question? Sorry, I've dealt with the three of them.
It was quite about a lot of this cryptocurrency morning. And the hype.
Cryptocurrency. Okay, right. The most sensible thing that's happened this week, of course, cryptocurrencies are going to come under attack from hackers. That's pretty obvious, isn't it? I mean, again, if you want to get into that business, then it's completely up to you. I thought the wisest thing to have happened this week was that Mr. White Hat was actually employed, was offered a job by the company he or she originally stole from. And if you're going to defend yourself, then who better to do it than a thief? Because they're the people that know all the defensive cracks in your cryptocurrency systems. Good for them. That's the story of the week, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, thank you very much, right. Michael Wilson.
All right, thank you, Michael. And concerning, knowing the end of all this glut in semiconductors and chip, I think you should just dial 1-800-KOREA or Taiwan. All right. For updates on COVID-19 pandemic, Adesua Moro is here with us. Adesua, great to have you.
Thank you. Good morning, guys. And let me just quickly say that I don't imagine any robot replacing you anytime soon, Tundu.
Well, thank you, darling.
I mean, that's reassuring.
I'm relieved.
Where is that coming
really?
From?
That's reassuring.
I'm not into
yes,
that inside
I'm,
baseball.
I'm reaching what you from the nation's capital
baseball?
This morning. Work exigencies.
Oh, okay.
Sorry?
I don't get that.
But let's look at the latest statistics.
I'll fill you in a bit.
Yeah, really?
So let's look at the latest figures. According to the Johns Hopkins University, over 4.4 million people have been infected with the coronavirus. And unfortunately, we've had, of course, 210 million people infected. Majority recover from this virus. Again, a reminder that we're beginning to see those who recover but still have symptoms of the virus, otherwise known as long COVID. Our distribution of vaccines continue globally. Over 4.8 billion doses have now been administered worldwide. In the last 24 hours here in Nigeria, the country has recorded additional 8 COVID-related deaths and 674 new infections here in Nigeria. Lagos posted more than half of the new infections for Nigeria. Meanwhile, the WHO has raised concerns over increasing COVID fatalities in West Africa amid Ebola and other disease outbreaks in the sub-region. Now, COVID-19 fatalities in West Africa over the past 4 weeks increased by 193%, taking the numbers of fatalities from 348 in the previous 4 weeks to 1,018 in the week ending August 15. The WHO regional director, Dr. Mashitizo Moeti, says 9 of the 23 countries experiencing a resurgence are in West Africa, and some of them are tackling other disease outbreaks, which further weakens their pre-existing fragile health systems. In particular, she mentioned Côte d'Ivoire, Guinea, and Nigeria. On vaccines, Dr. Moeti says, although West Africa has received about the same amount of doses as East and Southern Africa, West Africa has administered the least doses. So vaccination remains very slow in West Africa. And it would seem as if more and more, the WHO's appeal for whether nations to halt booster shots seems to have fallen flat. In Israel, the health minister has revealed plans to expand its booster campaign, allowing people over 40 and teachers to be eligible for a third dose of the Pfizer-BioNTech COVID-19 vaccine. Israel began administering third doses to people over 60 in July, and later dropping the minimum age of eligibility to 50 and offering boosters to health workers and others in the country. Meanwhile, in the UK, Health Secretary Sajid Javid says a COVID vaccine booster scheme will take place and is likely to start next month. He says the exact start date remains uncertain as the government was waiting for the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunization final advice. They are the advisory body for the government on vaccination. And Mr. Javid added that the most vulnerable will certainly be the first in line to receive those booster shots when they eventually begin in the UK.
Well, on booster shots, the issue is as follows. I think we need to be reminded of the position of the WHO in this regard. The WHO says that, yes, you know, if you give booster shots, then you are violating, it's unethical. That's what the WHO says. And you'll be violating, you know, the need for vaccine equity. Dr. Ghebreyesus said that yesterday. Mike Ryan, the director in charge of global health emergencies, says that, look, this is like giving an extra life jacket to people who have already been saved. And I think we need to reiterate that. And that was also the point that Dr. Moeti, the WHO regional director for Africa, was making yesterday. But the bigger point that she made was about the low vaccine rollout in Africa. Second, also, the fact that many of these African countries are now beginning to deal with Ebola and also what is called the Marburg virus disease. And that in itself makes the challenge that we face grossly complex. In Sydney, in Australia, New South Wales, there's been new lockdown. And I think it's important to look at what is happening in New South Wales State in Australia, where in fact for you to travel 50 kilometers, you will need a vaccine passport, even within your own state. And you are required to take a test every week if you are going to move out of Greater Sydney to any other part of New South Wales.
Well, just after your report yesterday, I had a look at the Western media just to see if that rebuke by Ghebreyesus was gaining any traction. The answer is no. The Western media is really focused on all their governments getting, you know, booster jabs into arms before flu season. They're only thinking about their populations and protecting their populations. So the lesson is there for us. We're really on our own, quite frankly.
For me, the takeaway today will be the sad passing of Mohamed Fawemi, the son of, you know, the great lawyer Gani Fawemi, and the statement released today by yesterday by the family that says he died of COVID-19. But if he had taken the jab, probably he would have survived. So please go out there. COVID is real. If you can, get the jab, get vaccinated, and still observe those pharmaceutical measures. It's really important. Thank you. Thank you, Adesua, for your time.